Welcome to the Christian House of Prayer's midweek service. Tonight's message comes from the series entitled The Beatitudes of the Fear of the Lord. Tonight's subtitle will be The Lord Will Return, He's Coming.
You know, our last time together, we were talking about the danger of not being ready. And I hope we got that settled, amen? What we want is to be ready for the coming of the Lord, amen? Because the Lord is coming again, and He's coming soon. And God is infinitely more pleased with those of us who live our lives in the wake of that, expecting Jesus Christ to come, than to put it off, the scripture says, and say He's not coming, and He comes back, and we're not ready. And how do we become ready? You must be saved and serving the Lord. Say that. Saved and serving. Because God has not called us to be saved and then go back out into the world and serve the devil. Salvation is not fire insurance. It's not just missing hell and going to heaven. No, salvation is worshiping God and serving God. And so we come this morning to this message that I want to share with you, and that's the Lord will return. The Lord is real. The Lord will return and the Lord will repay. We're talking about the Lord will return. As a subtitle, I want to talk about He's coming. Can you say that? He's coming. One more time. He's coming. With authority. He's coming. When we began our ministry, Valerie, in the early part of our ministry, we had a brother to join our church by the name of Brother Riggs. And Brother Riggs had a close encounter of the God kind. He had an encounter with God. We call it a visitation. The Lord visited this brother and took him into a vision and gave unto him a message and told him that I'm going to allow you to live, but you must carry forth my message. And the message was, He's coming. First time we met Brother Riggs is when he came into the church doors. The moment that he opened up the church doors, he began to shout while I was preaching, He's coming, He's coming, He's coming. I said, who are you talking? The Lord is coming. I said, we know that the Lord is coming. And I had him to sit down. And after the service, we talked to Brother Riggs. And then he shared with us the vision that he had. And this man, I mean, he had the profundity of his witness. And the power of those two words was altering the course of people's lives. He says, God's called me to tell people He's coming. And so he says, I want to come and sit in this ministry so you can teach me the Bible. Because he had no knowledge of the Bible. All he knew was two words, He's coming. That's what he got saved on. So he didn't know the Bible. So early on in our ministry, we had one of our first deacons by the name of Deacon Michael Knight. Deacon Michael Knight was a soul winner. This was our first year in the ministry. And Deacon Knight, what he would do, he would go down to downtown where the pimps and prostitutes and the drug pushers and drug addicts were, and he would pass out tracts and he would witness. So Brother Riggs, he says to Deacon Knight, he says, listen, please take me with you. He says, Pastor, is it all right for him to go? I said, yeah, he's got the message. He's coming. Take him with you. He said, please take me with you. He says, all right, we're going to go down there and witness and pass our tracts. It was a particular area downtown where all the drug dealers and pushers and pimps and prostitutes would be. And I'm not going to mention the territory right now, but when you came into that, the prostitutes would be propositioning folk. When Deacon Knight drove up into this area, you see all the traffic going on. He said, there he go. And before he could park his car, Brother Riggs jumped out of the car and began to run towards the people, and he was shouting, He's coming! He's coming! He's coming! And the people began to scatter, run everywhere. They thought he was talking about the police were coming. He's coming! He's coming! And folk were running and everything. And Deacon Knight said, he says, I said, now Lord, something's wrong here. And then he says, that the Lord said, yeah, tell him this. And he told Riggs, he said, Riggs, let us catch him first. Then tell him he's coming. Then tell him he's coming. The testimonies go on and on and on about this man, Brother Riggs. He was a profound witness for the Lord. I mean, when he walked into a place, just something electrifying about this man. About 11 p.m., Brother Riggs came to our home, Valerie and I. We were getting ready to go to bed. And when I opened up the door, he rang the bell. When I opened up the door, here was Brother Riggs. He marched into my house. He didn't ask, could he come in? Just walked right in. And he had four guys with him. He said, come on in. And he was directing them. And I'm standing there watching Brother Riggs. And Brother Riggs brings these four guys in, two black, one white, and one Hispanic. Different ages. And they walked in as if they were zombies. I mean, he said, come in, like he was commanding them. And they just walked in. He said, sit down. And they sat down. And I said, Riggs, what's going on? He says, they have come so you can preach and they want to be saved. I says, now Riggs, I said, well, who are these guys? I said, he says, I don't know. I picked them up on the street. Now, this is a true story. He said, I don't know. I picked them up on the street. I said, you picked them up on the street. I said, so they sitting there, sitting quiet, grown men sitting there, eyes big as a saucer, as if they've seen something from outer space. And I'm looking at them. I said, so they don't know each other? He said, no, they never met. He said, I picked them up on the street. I said, so y'all don't know each other? And they said, no. They looking at each other? No. I said, well, what is this, Riggs? He says, no, they need to be saved. And I said, well, Riggs, how did you get them to come in the car and come with you? He says, I told them, he's coming, he's coming, he's coming. And we led them into the Lord Jesus Christ. Valerie, you tell them. We asked them, do you want to be saved? And all of them just shook their head. And man, listen, I mean, I was so excited about this thing. I took it a step further. I said, well, not only salvation, but do you want to get filled with the Holy Ghost? And they all said, yeah. I said, do you want to get baptized? Yes. Whatever we was offering, they wanted to get it because of the impact of this man's witness and two words, he's coming. Let me tell you something. One of the things that's missing in our gospel message today, and that is the ingredients of the coming of the Lord. Yes, sir. You're not even hearing that now. Thank God for the prosperity. We need that. Thank God for all. But if you're going to preach the gospel, I'm talking about the full and the whole gospel. What is the gospel? The gospel is the death, burial, resurrection, ascension, and return of the Lord Jesus Christ. One of the reasons why we have people, even in the church, who's living like Jesus Christ is not real is because they're not hearing the message that he is coming. And that one day we all will stand before God to give an account for what we've done while we're here on this planet. Something about Paul's message when he preached the gospel, I want you to see it this morning. When Paul preached the gospel, Paul, he always had in his message somewhere about the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we're living in a day and time, very likely preachers probably are going to criticize me and say, you need to stop telling people about the Lord is coming and we need to be occupying while we're down here. And the reason why we're not occupying the way we should down here is because we fail to recognize that we're not going to stay down here. We're going to be caught up together with the Lord to meet the Lord. We're going to go into what is called the Bema or the judgment seat of Christ and then go into the marriage supper of the Lamb. And then there'll be 1,000 years when the Lord restored this planet called Earth. 1,000 years reign where there'll be no devil, no demons, no bad, no evil. 1,000 years. But until that time, we need to know that the Lord Jesus Christ, he's coming. The Bible talks about the last days. And on the day of Pentecost, it began the last days. Because Joel prophesies and said in the last days that the Spirit of God will be poured out upon all flesh. When did that happen? That happened on the day of Pentecost. Close to 2,000 years ago. And so now we're living in the last of the last days. There will come a last day. A last day. A last day for those of us who are saved and a last day for those who are not. There will come a last day, a last day. And so the Bible teaches us, according to the book of Psalms, Lord, teach us to number our days so that we can apply wisdom into our lives. I want you to see here something about the Apostle Paul's message before we get too far into what I want to share. Starting with chapter 2, are you there? Look at chapter 1 first. Look at the gospel. Let's look at the gospel because, Valerie, one of the ingredients that's missing out of the gospel message, and pastors will be held accountable for not preaching the whole gospel. Now, when you talk about prosperity and you talk about things along that line, that's called the counsel of God. But the gospel stands on its own two feet. And the gospel deals with the death, burial, resurrection, the ascension, and the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Notice what Paul says in chapter 1, verse 5. Are you there? For our gospel, say it, come on. For our gospel. Whose gospel is it? It's our gospel. He's called and commissioned every one of us to go and share the good news that he's coming. The Lord will return. For our gospel came not unto you in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Ghost and in what? Much assurance, as you know what manner of men we were among you for your sake. Our gospel came. Say, our gospel came.
Our gospel came.
And if we're going to preach the gospel, we got to also include the Lord's coming. Say, the Lord's coming.
The Lord's coming.
The Lord will return.
The Lord will return.
Now notice what he says in chapter 2, verse 1. For what is our hope or joy or crown of rejoicing? Now, when we talk about the rewards of the Lord, we're going to get into the five crowns. Most people never even heard of the five crowns. And when we talk about crowns, we're not talking about so that we can go up in heaven and wear crowns on our head. No, you get the opportunity to lay them at his feet. But the crowns are dealing with the rewards that the believers shall receive. You don't want to miss that, because there are some crowns that's going to be given to some of you. For what is our hope? Say hope.
Hope.
One more time. What is our hope? Say hope.
Hope.
Or joy or crown of rejoicing. Are not even ye in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ? Notice now, at his coming. At his coming. Paul talked about the coming of the Lord. At his coming. Chapter 3. Look at verse 13. To the end he may establish your hearts unblameable in holiness. Are you listening to this? That he may establish your hearts how? Unblameable in holiness. What are we talking about? Having our hearts established in the fear of the Lord. And when you talk about the fear of the Lord, you cannot separate the holiness of God. The reason why some people are not walking in their holiness or their sanctification is because they're not hearing about the fear of the Lord, that the Lord is real and that the Lord will return. So he says again, to the end, he may establish your hearts unblameable in holiness before God, even our Father, at, notice now, at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ with all his saints. We find Paul in Paul's letter, he's preaching about the coming of the Lord. He did not leave that out of his message. He's preaching the coming of the Lord. And then, of course, in chapter 4, verse 15 again. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain until the what?
Coming
of the Lord. Say it again. Coming of the Lord. Say, he's coming.
He's coming.
Now look at chapter 5, verse 2. For yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord, what? I'll wait for you to get there. You need to see it. This is chapter 5, verse 2. For yourselves know perfectly that the what? Day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night. It's coming like a thief in the night. And then let's conclude this by looking at verse 23. Look at verse 23. And the very God of peace, notice how Paul closes it out. And the very God of peace sanctify you wholly. And I pray God your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless. Where? Unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Faithful is he that called you, who also will do it. So the coming of the Lord is a message that need to be heard in order for us to walk in the fear of the Lord. Now turn back to chapter 4, and we want to begin to dissect this, starting with verse 13 again. But I would not have you to be ignorant. To be ignorant. He's not calling people stupid. He says ignorant. Ignorance is a commentary on what you don't know. Stupidity is on what you know and you don't do. He is saying, let me reveal something to you that you don't know. I don't want you to be without this knowledge about the Lord's coming. But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that you sorrow not. This is verse 13. Are you there? Even as others which have no hope. Say, which have no hope. Now underscore this word hope, because when we talk about the Lord's coming and when we talk about that the Lord will return, the first thing I want us to focus in on of 1 Thessalonians is the delight of being raptured ready. The delight of being raptured ready. Paul is preaching and encouraging the church at Thessalonica about the coming of the Lord and about them being raptured ready. What they were concerned about is that some people had already died, and they were living in such a way and such with such power and puissance and with such alacrity and enthusiasm. They were living in such a way because so far as they was concerned, they believed the message of Paul. And Paul said, you did not receive this as the message from a man, but you received it as it is in truth, the message of God. And they believed Paul's message. And so they got busy and they were serving the Lord as if the Lord was coming back today. But then some people died. And so some of them were getting discouraged. And they says, well, is he truly coming? And Paul began to encourage them about being raptured ready. There is a delight to be raptured ready. See, some people are not ready for their rapture. Are you listening to me? Some people are not ready for their rapture. You want to be raptured ready, because when Jesus comes back, he says he's coming like a thief in the night. You won't have time to go and get ready. Hello. You know, that's like if you know that you're going to go somewhere, if you're a paratrooper and you're going to go somewhere and you got to jump out of that airplane. There's no time to get your parachute on when you got to jump out. When they're pushing you out of there, you better have your chute ready. Hello. And so we got to be raptured ready when Jesus comes, because he's not coming and waiting on anybody. So the concept Paul is saying is that these people had a delight in being raptured ready. Say, I want to be raptured ready. A little louder. I want to be raptured ready. Now, Paul says that they had this hope. The uniqueness about the Christian's hope is different from the world's hope. Paul uses this word hope. What does it mean? I want you to hold your finger there and go to the book of Titus. This is 1 Thessalonians. Let's move over a little bit to the book of Titus. Since you're in 1 Thessalonians, you come to 2 Thessalonians, 1 and 2 Timothy, and then we're in Titus. Notice what he says in Titus chapter 2. It's a special kind of hope that Paul is talking about. The Christian hope is not like the hope of the world. It's a special kind and quality of hope. I will explain that in just a moment. But notice what he says in Titus chapter 2, starting with verse 11. For the grace of God that brings salvation. It's the grace of God that does what? That brings salvation that appeared to all men. Teaching us. Notice that, appear to all men. Look at somebody next to you and say, the grace of God and salvation has appeared to me.
The grace of God and salvation has appeared
to me. Now tell that person, that's why I'm saved.
That's why I'm saved.
Yeah, that's why I'm saved. It's appeared to all men. But then he comes down and say, verse 12, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live. He's telling us how to live in the fear of the Lord, that the Lord will return. We should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. How do we do that? Verse 13, looking for that what? Blessed hope. Shout it three times. Blessed hope. Blessed hope. Blessed hope. What kind of hope is this? A blessed hope. It's called the blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. It's a blessed hope. Now see, the hope of the Christian is different from the hope of the world. The hope of the world is this kind of hope. You know, it's like you go outside and there's a, you know, you see the clouds out there and there's thunder and lightning. And you say, I hope it doesn't rain. That's wishful thinking. See, that's the way the world has its hope. It's like a person who don't show up for the whole week and don't call in and tell them that I'm not coming in. But then that following week, they come and they say, I hope I got a job. No, you don't. No, it's just wishful thinking. No sense of you even showing up. You didn't want the job. Hello. That's wishful thinking. That's the way that the world's hope is. I hope after you get the report. Oh, I hope. You see, no, that's the world's hope. But the Christian hope, it is a confident, favorable expectation. And the reason why the Christian hope is a confident, favorable expectation is because we take Jesus Christ at his word. If Jesus say he's coming, then we can have a confident, favorable expectation. If Jesus say he's coming, we can have a confident, favorable expectation. So there is an expectation with, if you would, or with an anticipation based upon a celebration that's going to take place when Jesus comes. In other words, what happens when Jesus comes and take us? Where are we going? The Bible says we're going to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And the Bible teaches us that no matter what we have down here, it cannot compare to what we're going to experience when we're in the presence of the Lord, where there is the fullness of joy. And at his right hand, there are pleasures evermore. No matter what it is, it's exciting. It's better than Disneyland. It's better than Magic Mountain, kids. Hallelujah, somebody. Hallelujah. You're going to go on a roller coaster that nothing down here can ever compare with. Because when you're raptured, you're caught up together with the Lord. Oh, glory to God. I feel my afro growing. Now, this is a delight of, if you would, a delight because I have an expectation that there's going to be a celebration when Jesus take us up. There's going to be a celebration. You know, it's like the kind of anticipation and celebration that we have when a loved one has gone away for a very long time and that person is returning, like the soldiers, when the soldiers are coming back and their wives and their children and everybody is down there waiting for their return. What a joy it's going to be. And do you know what happens when that person had that kind of anticipation? There's a house cleaning. You start, mama start getting things. Now, if your wife don't, I tell you, your mother will. Amen. Praise the Lord. You know, if your mother know you coming home and you've been away for 3 and 4 years and 5 years, glory to God. I mean, she may go out there and get a fresh paint, paint job on the house. She gonna have your room decked out. She gonna have you a new comfortable bed, at least a pillow. I mean, she's waiting on you. Glory to God. Mama waiting on you to come home. Can I hear you say amen?
Amen.
It's an exciting thing. And what does she do? Mama goes and tells everybody, guess what? My son is coming home. I remember Joe Walker was telling me about how that his mother, when she knew that Joe was coming home, she got strength like Superwoman. I mean, she began to do all kinds of things, prepare all kinds of meals. Why? Because her Joe is coming home. And what she was doing was telling everybody, my son's coming home. In another week, he's coming back. See, when you really believe that the Lord is coming, like Brother Riggs, you begin to tell people, listen, I'm getting excited. I'm getting ready. Why? Jesus is coming. We're going to have a blast. We're going to have a good time. Oh, glory to God. One day you'll be kicking up gold dust. Glory to God. 1,000 miles a moment. Glory to God. Moving from one galaxy to the next. It's exciting. It's awesome. When you get caught up, you'll be caught out. All you have to do is just think about a particular place. Like New York, just think. And when you blink your eyes, you're there. I mean, that's what the Bible teaches. In a moment, in the twinkling of the eye, the only thing that's holding us down here is the flesh and blood. Because flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of heaven. Now, flesh and bones are going to go. But what's keeping us here? We need the blood to operate down here. But when you get up there, it's spirit contact. Glory to God. Oh, I'm getting excited about this. No more sickness. No more dying. No more. No more falling out and no more falling down. I mean, everything is uprising. Everything is up. Everything is up. Everything is up. I said everything is up. Every day is an up day. Ain't no down days up there. All your down days is why you're down here. Ain't no down days up there. Every day is up. I mean, every day is up. Hallelujah. In the presence of your life-changing King. It's a delight to be raptured ready. To be ready. And when you're ready, how you know you're ready? You're telling somebody about Jesus. You're telling somebody about the one that saved you. You're looking for that glad and wonderful day. You're looking for the day when he will split the eastern sky and come back himself for his church. It's called the delight of being rapture ready. Just go ahead and take a moment, somebody, and tell somebody, I'm delighted. Glory to God. Tell them why. I'm rapture ready. Go ahead. I'm rapture ready. I'm rapture ready. I'm delighted because I'm rapture ready. Something I need you to see also here, because he says in the book of Thessalonians chapter 4, are you there? verse 15, verse 14. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, see, we believe that Jesus died and rose again. History tells us Jesus died. And it tells us that he rose again because they haven't found his body. His body was not there. The angel appeared and said, why look ye of the living among the dead? He's not here. And I don't want to spend a lot of time there with that. Glory to God. But they had they had soldiers guarding his tomb because it was already said. And the Jews said, put extra soldiers on because his men, his disciples may come and try to steal his body. So they had extra soldiers at the tomb to guard and to keep. And yet and still, on that early Sunday morning, when they looked around, the tomb was open. And they said, who opened up the tomb? And the Bible says that the women on their way to the burial, see, something about women, God can really count on women. Because when Jesus died and when they buried him, the disciples gave up. They got to this, how are we going to do this thing? I mean, he's dead now. But the women on their way to the burial, the Bible says that they were asking the question on their way, who's going to roll away the stone? What's the sense in going to the grave if you don't have somebody that's going to roll away the stone? None of the men would come with them to roll away the stone. And they were asking each other, who's going to roll away the stone? And when they got there, the stone was already rolled away. Now hear me, the angel didn't have to roll away no stone for Jesus to come out. He had to roll away the stone for them to get in to see that he was gone. He wasn't there. Jesus wasn't there. He says, for if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, them also which sleep or die in Jesus will God bring with him. Jesus is bringing them with him. We're going to explain that. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain, we which are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. Watch this now. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven. Say it. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven. So here's the point here. First of all, there is the delight of being rapture ready. Second of all, there is the descent of the Lord's return. Say it. The descent of the Lord's return. Notice again, it says for the Lord himself. He's not sending Gabriel back. That would be fine. He's not sending, glory to God, Michael back. That would be fine. No, it says the Lord himself shall descend. I said the Lord himself shall descend. You know, when Elijah went home or went to heaven, a whirlwind and an angelic host came for him. But the Lord himself is coming. Oh, I'm getting excited thinking about this. See, because the Lord want to see us. The first face, I thank God that heaven is real. Heaven is as real and more real than you are even here this morning. Heaven is more real than you being here this morning. It's a real place. It ain't no Casper the Friendly Ghost or Spooky or something out there. It's real. Because the Bible teaches us that Moses and Elijah had died. And listen now. Hundreds of years later, they appeared with Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration. And the disciples never saw what Moses nor Elijah looked like. They did not have any pictures back then. And yet when they looked and they saw Moses and Elijah, they knew immediately that's Moses and that's Elijah. You will know who's who when you get there. Ain't no guessing game up there. Everybody's going to be known. Hallelujah. Oh, don't you want to go where everybody knows your name? You're not going to have to introduce yourself to nobody. You want to walk up and somebody going to say, hey, there's Nate Holcomb there. Glory to God. Don't you want to go? Everybody knows your name up there. You don't have to wear no badges up there. Everybody knows who everybody is. They knew who Moses and Elijah was. And Moses and Elijah didn't appear in some type of Casper, the Friendly Ghost body. No, they had a body. There are bodies in heaven. And I just simply said that when I get to heaven, one of the faces I definitely want to see is my mommy's. I want to see my mother's face. But before I see mama's face, I want to see Jesus. I want to make sure that I'm in the right place. Glory to God. Let me always see his face first, because the Lord himself shall descend. That's the first one you see. If you see anybody else's face, you may be in the wrong place. First one you got to see is Jesus. He's coming for his own. So there is the descent of the Lord's return. It says, for the Lord himself. Are you there? For the Lord himself shall what? Descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Now, this is exciting. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up. Say, caught up. A little louder, please. That's where we get the word rapture. The word rapture itself is not in the Bible. But where we get the word rapture is this word caught up. Where it says, then we which are alive and remain shall be what? Caught up together with them. Ooh, glory to God. I got to tell you, this is so exciting to me. We shall be caught up together with them. Now remember, here's the point. They were wondering, Lord, what about the people that have died? This was their concern. Are they going to miss this? He said, no, they're not going to. Now watch this. They're not going to miss this. They're not going to miss this event called the rapture. And at the rapture, you get resurrected bodies. These two things go together, hand in hand. The resurrection is because you're being raptured. And when you are raptured, you get resurrected. Now, the difference between being resurrected and raised from the dead. If you're raised from the dead, and which we've had in this ministry, we've had people in this church raised from the dead. We've raised people from the dead. What's the difference? Well, they got to die again. There's another funeral we got to go to. Come on, if Jesus said, Terry is coming. But in the resurrection, there is no more dying. When you're resurrected into your eternal and everlasting abode. So at the resurrection is the rapture, or the rapture is the resurrection. Do you get that? Say it. The rapture is the resurrection. You're not going up unless you've been resurrected. So there's got to be a resurrection. So what Paul was saying was those who have already died, no, they're going to experience the resurrection at the rapture. They're going to experience the resurrection at the rapture. The Lord himself shall descend. Now watch this. The Lord himself shall descend with the shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God. And the dead, watch it now, the dead in Christ shall rise first. We just read where it says that God will bring them with him. This is awesome. Picture this in your mind. God's going to bring them with him. So when Jesus comes, now Jesus at this coming, Jesus' feet will never touch the earth. It will never touch the earth. Not at this coming. He's not coming back to judge the nations. He's coming back to evacuate his church or his people. At this coming, he's only coming to get us out. After the church has been removed, 2 Thessalonians, take your time and read it in your own devotion. After the church has been removed, it says after the hindrance has been removed, then that man of prediction called the Antichrist will show up. Now, he can't show up. The Antichrist ain't showing up until you get out. He ain't as dumb as he look. I said he's not as dumb as he look. The Antichrist will not show up until the church has been raptured out. And then when the church is raptured out of the world, there will be such catastrophes up on this planet and things that will happen in this world and in this planet. And let me say, if you are here, if you are not raptured ready, if you are here, whatever you do, don't take the mark of the beast. You'll be doomed forever. And the Bible says that in that day, in order for you to buy and sell, you have to have the mark of the beast. And the mark of the beast and the Antichrist is of the devil, meaning you're doomed forever to hell. You've got to get raptured ready. And if you're not raptured ready, whatever you do, don't take the mark of the beast, because this life is only but a vapor. So what if you die? You're going to heaven. But whatever you do, if you miss this train, don't take the mark of the beast. And you don't want to be down here during that time. Because he says that there will be such tribulation. You think tsunamis, there'll be tsunamis everywhere. There'll be earthquakes everywhere. There'll be floods. I mean, we've already had a foretaste of this. One city was wiped out. And the Bible teaches us how that the whole earth and the planet was destroyed before with the days of Noah. We have testimony of this. There will come such a fire. And there will be such a holocaust. And the Bible says in the book of Revelation that the people in that day are going to cry out and beg the rocks to fall upon them so they can die. And will not be able to die. He's talking about chemical warfare. People's flesh burning up off of them. And they want to die and can't die. It's going to be hell on earth. That's what it means. There will be hell on earth. The Bible says the devil know that his time is shortly coming. So he's going to come down and do everything he can because he know that his judgment day is coming. And he's going to try to take everybody he can. He know he's going to hell. Where's the devil now? He's not in hell. Hell is reserved for the devil and for his angels. He's not in hell. He's on planet earth, walking to and fro, seeking whom he may devour. He want to take you to hell with him. He know that's where he's going. But you got to be raptured ready. This ain't no plaything, people. One thing is for sure, all of us know that the graveyard is real. People die, and where do they go? Where will you spend eternity? Are you rapture ready? And if the church is raptured out because there is an evacuation plan. The greatest debacle of New Orleans, it wasn't the fact of Hurricane Katrina. It was that they did not have a proper evacuation plan to get the people out. And anybody, and Jesus is a carpenter, he's a builder. He know if he's going to build anything, you got to have an evacuation plan. In case of an emergency, take the nearest exit. And when hell is released upon this planet, God's going to give us the nearest exit. All at one time, he's taking his church out. The Lord shall descend from heaven with the voice of the archangel and with the trump of God. And he says, the dead in Christ shall rise first. What shall he shout? I don't know, but I believe perhaps he's going to shout every person's name. God can do it. You know that. The same way that he shouted, Lazarus, come forth. He didn't just say come forth because everybody in the grave would have came forth. He said, no, Lazarus, come forth. When the Lord descends, he's going to shout every person's name. And the dead in Christ, watch it, Val, dead in Christ. That means Mama Nelly, glory to God. Mama Nelly's going to rise first, but she's not going to beat me up. But see, because when she comes back, she got to get back in that old body. Well, Bishop, suppose they were cremated. All the particles and all that stuff is still here. You read it, the Bible says that the dead must, listen, that the sea must give up their dead. Death and hell must give up their dead. All the particles, everything is still here. When the dead comes back, glory to God, the Bible says that the dead shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain. Stand up, Valerie, glory to God. The same way that Valerie got up, that's it. She ain't going no further than that. And when the dead rise first, Valerie, they rise first. But then we shall be caught up together. Caught up together. Think with me. Why do you think that we worship sometimes with our hands lifted up? It's a sign of surrendering, but it's also a sign of being lifted up. When a little kid see their parent coming, first thing they want to do is run and hold up their hands. Why? So daddy can lift me up. When we lift up our hands, you can tell who's rapture ready. People who's used to lifting up their hands. There will come an occasion when you lift up your hands, glory to God, and glory to God. And when you lift up your hands, daddy's going to pick you up. I said he's going to pick you up. You're going 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 up. A little boy was weeping and wailing and crying before his mother. She said, what are you crying for? He said, Mommy, I'm afraid when Jesus comes, I'm afraid that I'm not going to be caught up with the Lord. She says, son, you don't need to cry about that, but I'm not sure if I'm going to be caught up. She says, son, if you're caught up with him now, you'll be caught up with him then. See, the problem is some of us are not raptured. We're not caught up with the Lord now. We got to be caught up with him now. We got to have a passion for him, a heart for him, a drive for him, a thirst for him. As the deer panteth for the water brook, so my soul longeth after thee. Jesus is coming back. I said he's coming back. And there must be, number one, the delight of being rapture ready, but also the descent of the Lord's return. Let me just share these two verses of scripture with you, and perhaps we'll get ready to close. I feel a rapture coming now. Glory to God. Woo! Hallelujah. Notice what it says in the book of Luke's gospel. Turn there, Luke chapter 24. Hallelujah. Choir, are you ready? And choir, just because you are higher than us, you won't go up first. No, we'll be caught up together. Luke's gospel chapter 24, look at the 49th verse. 24 verse 49. Are you there? Hallelujah. Look at verse 49. Now here's my point. This is prior to Jesus ascending and leaving the planet. We're talking about the descend of the Lord's return, which is the departing, or how Jesus left. Say, how he left. Notice what it says. Now here's Jesus getting ready to leave. And behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you. But tarry ye where? In the city of Jerusalem, until ye be endued with power from on high. And he led them out as far as Bethany. This is awesome, people. Hold yourselves. You may get raptured on this one. And he led them out as far as Bethany. And he lifted up his hands, just like I said, and blessed them. And it came to pass, while he blessed them, he was parted from them and carried where? Up into heaven. And they worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy, and were continually in the temple praising and blessing God. Amen. Look at Acts chapter 1. Acts chapter 1. Go there. Acts chapter 1. The departing of how Jesus left. Acts chapter 1. There must be the delight of being raptured ready. My God, I'm just raptured ready. I'm excited. What are you so excited about? I'm ready. I'm ready whenever he comes. I'm ready. Say, I'm ready.
I'm ready.
Bishop Jake's been trying to tell us what. Come on, everybody. Get ready, get ready, get ready, get ready. Yeah, you better be ready. We got to be ready. I'm raptured ready. And then there's the descent of the Lord's return. Watch this now. This is how Jesus left. He gives unto us an example, if we believe the testimony of the Lord. Verse 8, but you shall receive power after that. The Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses, just like Brother Riggs. The profundity of his witness and the power of those two words. He's coming. People believed it because there was something dynamic in his life. After the Holy Ghost has come upon you, you should be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria, and unto the uttermost parts of the earth. Now watch it. And when he had spoken these things while they beheld, this is awesome, Valerie. And when he had spoken these things while they beheld, he was what? Taken up. That's rapture. He was taken up. And a cloud. See, he should descend from heaven with the voice of the archangel and with the trump of God. The dead in Christ shall rise first, and we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them. Where? In the cloud. Same thing that happened to Jesus, in the cloud. And he was taken up, and a cloud received them out of their sight. Now somebody, I don't believe that. I don't believe that. What are you trying to tell me? Yeah, I'm saying that as Jesus was blessing them, he was received up. Can you picture that? You know, when Valerie and I, we redid our vows, if you were not here, let me tell you what happened. Valerie comes strutting down the aisle, this long aisle, and she was strutting. I mean, listen, she was in the groove too, boy. And man, I mean, and I'm looking at my wife for 25 years, we getting ready to redo our vows, and she come walking down. I don't know what's next. I got all of my kids there. My grandkids are in the wedding. My father in the faith, Papa Miller, he's doing the wedding for us. Handsome, but older man, older than me. And my handsome father right here, gray head, he was my right-hand man because I was still the best man in my wedding. He's just a better man than I am, but I was the best man. I wanted to make sure that Valerie had no second thoughts about nobody, amen? And when Valerie came down here, boy, I was waiting to receive my wife, and I didn't know that she had them to make. I mean, Valerie had them to make her a contraction, but it looked like it was a step. And when she got down here, she stepped up on a step. And next thing I know, that step started rising. I thought it was the rapture. I said, Lord, we're going up. We're going up. We're going up. I mean, that thing started going up. Boy, that took some nerve for Valerie, because suppose that thing, Valerie, had it just shot up like that. Dana, suppose it just shot her up. I was thinking, suppose that thing just shoot her up like that. And then God says, then you'll rapture her and catch her in your arms. Glory to God in the highest. When you're caught up, Jesus will rapture you and catch you. And the Bible says Jesus himself, he ascended up into a cloud. Isn't that exciting? Now, the world may not believe it the same way they did not believe that there would be rain coming down. And they never saw rain. They never saw anything such as water coming from the sky. But God said that he would flood the earth, and he caused Noah to build a boat. Up until this time, they needed no boat. And they mocked his message and said, who ever heard of such a thing? Water coming down from the ground. Because the original intent is still today. Water comes up from the ground, not from the sky. They say, how's that going to be? And you got people today, you trying to tell me that one day, yes, one day you'll look around and the Bible says one will be taken and the other one will be left. And it's already set up now. The Antichrist is already setting this thing up now. People, you know, in terms of flying saucers and all this, close encounters of the third kind, people coming out here, taking people, taking them somewhere else, so that when Jesus Christ come back in the second coming, all eyes would see him, and it says that the whole planet is going to make war against God. It's called Star Wars. But until that time, no one will see him, we'll only hear him, and he'll catch us up. You got to be, what is it? Rapture ready. Come on, say it again. You got to be rapture ready. Notice what he says in verse 10. And while they, that is the disciples, looked steadfastly toward heaven, they were amazed. As he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which also said, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus. Now watch it now. Here it is. Here it is. This same Jesus, which is taken up from you into heaven, so shall come in like manner, the same way he went up in a cloud. That's the way he's coming back. In like manner as you have seen him go into heaven. Then they returned unto Jerusalem and start preaching and proclaiming and doing signs and wonders. Why? Because they said he's coming. And they had such an anticipation and expectation of the coming of the Lord that they lived holy. Because they knew that they would stand before the living Savior, Jesus Christ, and give an account for what they've done in their lives. And so in Hebrews chapter 9, turn there. Hebrews chapter 9. Hebrews the 9th chapter, please. Chapter 9, verse 27. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27. Once you found your place, shout glory to God. Please hear this. This is such an important message for the body of Christ that you can be rapture ready. That there's going to be the descent of the Lord's return. And what should we do, Bishop? Ask me that question, please. What should we do? We should have the desire of the Lord's return. I'm desiring for the Lord to return. I'm desiring for the Lord to return. I'm looking forward to seeing Jesus. I'm not looking for an undertaker. I'm looking for an uppertaker. I'm looking forward. There is nothing more deadening for a person to live without an expectation of a blessed future. Because when you have something to look forward to, it motivates you to do what you should do now. When you know that I have a future and it's bright and it's beautiful, it's inevitable that every person here will stand before God. What are you going to do? What's the message? He's coming. Verse 27. And as it is appointed unto men once to die. All of us can say amen. That's what's going to happen. Amen. But after this, the judgment. So Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many. And unto them that look, unto them the blessed hope is looking for. Unto them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sin unto salvation. And what that means is those who are saved will look for him and he will appear unto them without sin. He's not coming to judge their sin. He's coming because they have received him in salvation. Father, we pray this morning with such enthusiasm, excitement because of what Jesus Christ has done for us in his death, his burial, his resurrection, his ascension, where he's seated now, according to the scriptures, on the right hand, praying for us, making intercession for us, that one day that he will come back, according to John chapter 14. Jesus, you said that I go to prepare a place for you, that where I am, there ye may be also, and I will come and receive you to myself. And you said, if it was not so, I wouldn't tell you that. I'm not trying to psych you out. I'm telling you that where I am, and Jesus, we thank you that you're alive. You proved yourself to be alive by many infallible proofs. And what's most important, that we don't have to wait until we stand before you in order for us to experience the life of you. That when we receive you, you come to live within our hearts. I can testify as well as many others this morning. That old things were passed away and all things became new, and how that I became a new person. I desire to have an opportunity. If I can just start all over again, and through you, Jesus, you gave me that opportunity and you caused me to be what the Bible says, born again. I'm thankful. We're thankful. We're thankful that we're saved unto salvation. Not only saved, but we're serving. We thank you that we can serve you with our time and talents and our treasures, our gifts, possession, even our money. We bless you, Jesus. We have such an anticipation, such an expectation, just like a soldier coming home to see his family. We thank you, Father, for the Bible teaches us that how that Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob was gathered together with their people. When they died, they were gathered together with their people. There were people there waiting for them. Thank you for those who have preceded us. But Lord, how that they were not, and how we will not prevent them. We'll be caught up together. And then we'll go and have that time that you said, the marriage feast of the Lamb. We don't know what all that is about, but we can have this confidence that we trust in you, that we know that it's better than anything that we've ever had here. Oh, taste, and we see that the Lord is good here. But we thank you, Father, for what you have prepared, Jesus. You said that you go to prepare a place for us. And in the Father's house, you said there are many mansions. And if it was not so, you would not tell us. Thank you that you have made a place for us. And heaven cannot sincerely be fully described. You said that the streets are paved with gold. Many of us are trying to hoard up gold, and that's what the streets are made out of, just gold. Streets are made out of gold. We thank you for that. We thank you, Lord, for giving unto us a glimpse of that which is to come, that we would be so motivated, most importantly, to see your face, to tell you how much we love you and how much we're grateful that you saved us, how you've been with us, how you are for us, how that you help us with our children, how that you've healed our sick bodies, how that you prepared a table before the presence of our enemies, how that you met our every need. We want to just praise you for 1,000 years for all the good that you've done. In Jesus' name, lift up your hands with your hearts to the God of the heavens, and we thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Just holding up your hands now to the God of the heavens. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Just thank him for a moment with me, saints. Let's take a few moments just to thank him in his presence. We just want to thank him. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You're worthy, Jesus. We love you, Jesus. We testify of how good you are to us. Just thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Just think about his love. Wherever you are in your life, his love is real in our hearts and our lives. Thank you, Jesus.
Please join me as we confess verses 13 through 15 of the 92nd Psalm. Those that be planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. They shall still bring forth fruit in old age. They shall be fat and flourishing. To show that the Lord is upright, he is my rock, and there is no unrighteousness in him. If you're in need of prayer, salvation, rededication, or church membership, counselors are standing by to take your call at 254-777-6292. Thank you.